We on time now.
Okay. Yeah, okay, we here.
We live.
Mm-hmm. So this the rap conversation, y'all, man. Rap talk. You feel me? Y'all can chime in and shit, you know what I'm saying? Y'all talk, we talk back. You feel me?
Yes.
How we starting this? Again.
Hazel started by saying, nigga, I'm finna wax a girl.
You said what?
I'm finna wax a girl who looks like Penelope Cruz. I'm wearing 70 shoes.
Niggas come through. Niggas gotta come through.
Hey, why niggas used to do that back in the day? Alpha D, for those of y'all don't know, we used to do that for hours. Niggas sit around just talking about, nigga be like, nigga, I'm motherfucking, nigga, I'm holding hot bologna dressed like Obi-Wan Kenobi. Nigga
be like, what? They come with the Ron, nigga. Nigga
be like,
awesome.
Nigga be like,
I usually choose to fuck. Wait a minute. I only choose to fuck a chick who choose to suck a dick. Had a man pacing back and forth on some Scrooge McDuck shit. You feel what I'm saying? Fucking, hold on. I say, nigga might dreaming of smelling Rihanna's twerk wind. When my pocket's hurting, I'm frantically searching in your mama's purse then. You feel what I say?
Nigga be like, I'm massaging your slim hoe. While I'm watching you soggy your Jimbo.
I'm gonna rob your Nintendo with a. We got two topics today. We'll start with his topic first. What's the first rap topic?
All right, so here's the thing, man. Yeah, so what I want to talk about is what I feel like is not said enough in hip hop. You know what I mean? Like, I watch a whole bunch of, hip-hop media, you know what I'm saying? And I listen to a bunch of podcasts, you know, a bunch of niggas that have long IGTV posts and stuff like that. What's not said enough is that West Coast lyricist is nowhere near where it should be.
As far as respect.
So, like, the lyricist on the West Coast is, and I touched on this real briefly on Judge's Table, but, I feel like, everybody knows that hip-hop started in the East Coast and the Bronx and Sedgwick Ave, all that good old shit, right? Everybody knows that. So, but because of that, like, it's way easier for an East Coast lyricist to thrive. Like, the underground East Coast MC is going to have way more success than his the West Coast counterpart. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. Like, the couple times we went to New York, the niggas over there that would be like the East Coast Horseshoe Gang or the East Coast Crook and Nas, I mean Crook and Rascals, nigga like that.
Yeah.
They're looked at a little differently. Like, so what I want to touch on is that, all right, number one, our shit started a little later than the East Coast shit. East Coast was getting super lyrical, super backpack, super boom bap before we did. So I feel like our Rakim is Cube. You know what I mean?
You're saying, like, the West Coast Rakim,
in my opinion, is Ice Cube. Uh-huh. Everything that came after Ice Cube is niggas incorporating lyricism a little more.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So everything before that was, you know, storytelling shit, gangbanging shit, just, you know, life rap, right? So when Cube came in, you know, got a murder rap to keep you dancing with a crime record like Charles Manson, all that kind of shit, is lyricism, punchline, metaphor, all that kind of shit.
Interesting.
Right? Now, Cube wasn't heavy with that, though.
Okay.
In my opinion, y'all can disagree with this all you want to. This is factual.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, it's Cube ushered in some lyricism, especially on the mainstream level. Then the next nigga that kind of took the torch was Corrupt.
You said Corrupt?
Corrupt. Now, don't get me wrong. DLC is a part of the Cube wave, I'm saying.
Okay.
Cube was like the head of that crop. Then the next crop was like the Corrupt shortly after. Now, Corrupt, I'm on a mainstream level. Crook was rapping probably longer than Corrupt.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as on a level that was got traction, it's probably Corrupt. Shortly after that, it's Crook and the class of niggas that came with Crook. So
okay.
We feel like we made a song called Crook Class on our mixtape monthlies, what we were basically saying is we're from the class we're from the class of niggas that studied under niggas like Crook. Yeah. So Crook, Razzcast, niggas like Planet Asia, niggas like what's the homie name? Sly Boogie. Niggas like that, that's the class Crook is from. And in our opinion, Crook is like the principal of that motherfucking class. Yeah. You know what I mean? So Crook, go back, do your history on West Coast hip hop. Everybody that came before Crook, not one person made the type of impact that Crook made that was punchline heavy.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Crook said some shit in that song he got with Locksmith. Shout out to Locksmith. The song is what is it called? It's called Blasphemer, where he's like contribution on the West. They wondering what's mine. Somewhere he was saying, I brought the heavy punchline.
Yeah.
Like Crook. Every rapper, like, I don't care if you talk about the Kendrick Lamars, I don't care if you're talking about the Absols, you're talking about the motherfucking battle rap niggas like the Daylights, all of them niggas,
they're gonna
either study from Crook or study from a nigga who studied from Crook.
Yes.
Right, so, so.
And they'll tell you.
Crook, like, the fact that he was on the Wake Up Show in motherfucking mid-early 90s.
And that's big, too.
That's big. That's some real shit. Like, so, all the niggas like the shout out to Swan Tech, too. The niggas like like the M&Ms and the Chino XLs and the Crooks, they got a big part of their footing in the game based on being seen on the Wake Up Show. Niggas studied Crooks' verse on the Wake Up Show and all his other shit with DJ Revolution and all that kind of shit. They studied that shit. That shit was groundbreaking for a West Coast rapper.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
yeah, Crook
ushered in the niggas like the Shoe Gangs, the Mike Strolls, niggas like
the Kendricks
and all those kind of niggas. And not to say those people wasn't rapping along with or around that time. I'm just saying it's basically Crook was carrying the torch.
Yeah, so because basically when you are a MC and you grow up loving hip-hop and listening to hip-hop and being influenced by hip-hop, you take a little bit from a lot of different people. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? You might take some type of, you might take the poetry side of hip-hop from Tupac. You might take some gangster shit from N.W.A. You might take the real technical lyricism from Eminem or Rakim or something. You know what I'm saying? So when it came to the real complex compound rhyming, multi-syllable rhyming, you know what I'm saying, punchline, and really deep, being real detailed with your bar.
Yeah.
When it comes to all of that shit, that was Crook. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. People took a lot. There's a lot of people that took that from Crook. And you might have took some Thug Passion from Pac or some being woke shit from Pac and Cube and shit like that.
Yeah, so Crook, I'm gonna circle back to my original point, but I have to explain, like, Crook is the West Coast lyrical miracle, heavy punchline, heavy simile GOAT. And there's no way around that. You know what I mean? But he comes from a class of niggas who was super, super pushing that. So shout out to them niggas. Like niggas like Razzcast with the Soul on Ice album, like that Nature of the Threat song and all that kind of shit. Mm-hmm. Like that type of shit was very vital and helpful for West Coast niggas, niggas like us, right? Yeah. So niggas like Crook, when Crook came with shit like when Crook was on Death Row, Crook was on a label that, especially at that time, niggas wasn't checking for no lyrical shit in the West Coast. West Coast was all but dead because Pac had just passed away.
Yeah.
Crook came right off the heels. You know how much pressure that would be? The one of the biggest rappers on the planet passed away, and then 3 years later, you get a record deal with Chug while he in jail, and you come out like, nigga, I gotta carry this torch, and then you want some lyricist shit? Crook, when Crook go to New York, go to the East Coast and shit like that, it's a fight. So Crook had to super, super, super carry the torch for West Coast lyricism, and I don't want that to be understated. So, and Crook came back to us, and you know we inherited some of the issues that the West Coast lyricists had. Like, I'm gonna give y'all some examples.
It's a Crook curse.
Yeah,
before you go into the example, let me just say this real quick. I have to put this in there. When Crook was over there on Death Row too, I remember 9/11 happened in 2001. Crook was on Death Row around that time and after that. So about like early 2002 or something like that. Yeah. Suge and all of Death Row and Crook and all them niggas that went to New York. They met up with Nas, met up with Jay-Z and shit. It was right in the middle of the beef between Jay-Z and Nas and shit. And right after 9/11, the nigga Crook went on Hot 97, had a line that I still remember to this day. He said he was on Hot 97 freestyling, getting it in, and the niggas he ended his rap with. He said, "I'm live on Hot 97, If I could rewind time, I would stop 9/11. And the whole motherfucking studio just went crazy because, you know, that was right after 9/11 in New York. You know what I'm saying? On Hot 97 and shit. That's the type of shit Crook was doing, nigga. That's years ago. So y'all got to think about that type of shit when you think about West Coast lyricists, specifically a nigga like Crook.
Yeah, so like when Crook, you know, Crook jumped off the porch early, like, you know, when Crook was with the Low Life Gangsters, shout out to the Low Life Gangsters, this is early 90s. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. At that point, there's not a lot of niggas you can point to outside of a Corrupt. You know what I mean? It was niggas in Long Beach. You know what I mean? It was niggas like the, you know, the Techniques, part of the LBC crew. It was niggas like Dynamic Certified, niggas like that. Niggas like Badass, R.I.P. Badass. And you know, Trey D is one of the lyrical gangbang goats.
Yeah, people sleep on Trey D.
So basically what we're kind of saying is there's numerous times we've been privy to information based on somebody else telling us. There's times we have firsthand account of niggas telling us, hey man, y'all need to dumb down though, man. Y'all coming out the West. If y'all ain't talking about, you know, low riders and gang banging and women in palm trees and weed, then y'all need to kind of dumb it down because there's no market for lyricism. And a lot of times when people hear us and they don't know where we're from, when we say something like Long Beach or Cali or throw the dub up, they're like, oh shit, I thought y'all was from Whoop Whoop. They thought we was from somewhere else. So it's that needs to stop because, like, and what we're saying is this, it's extremely, I feel like, as far as the West Coast is concerned, like, we have the hardest time for lyricists and rappers with substance to break through of any of the other major markets in hip-hop, any of them. Now, when I say that, I want to make sure I draw a distinction between saying we just have the hardest time in hip-hop, because there's people, if you're from Dakota, if you're from one of the markets that haven't established yourself yet, then they have way harder time than us. I don't want to shit on them. If you're from somewhere like, even if you're somewhere from overseas somewhere, you're trying to be the person to put your city and your region on the map, you have the most difficult time. Them motherfuckers have to. But I'm saying as far as Houston, Atlanta, New York, Detroit, Chicago, Cali, like the areas that already have established footing in the game, West Coast lyricists have the hardest time because there's a stigma and there's stay in your lane type shit.
Now, let me ask you a question. Hold on. Let me ask you this. I'm going to have to challenge you on that. Would you say West Coast, as far as lyricists, we have a hard time breaking through than, like, let's say, an Atlanta lyricist?
Sure.
Because down south, not just Atlanta, but the South in general, this is just me playing devil's advocate real quick. The South in general, they have their own issue. One of their stigmas they have is the fact that they mumble or they come with turn up trap type of music that ain't really talking about shit other than that. And they also have the stigma that they kind of like not really skilled as rappers, a lot of them. They fight.
Right.
So would you say we have it harder as West Coast rappers than they do as far as lyricists breaking through? Something to think about.